In a time long past, the armies of the dark came again into the lands of men. Their leaders became known as the Fallen Lords, and their terrible sorcery was without equal in the West. In 30 years, they reduced the civilized nations to carrion and ash, until the free city of Madrigal alone defied them. An army gathered there, and a desperate battle was joined against the Fallen.
Myth, The Fallen Lords, is a real-time tactical fantasy wargame, developed by Bungie Software and published in November 1997. Myth takes place in a dying world, where the forces of the Dark have all but triumphed over the mortal races, and only the battered legions of the Western Provinces are left to resist the Walking Dead. In these hopeless times, there are no foodstuffs or resources to gather, and no opportunity to train new men. Instead, players command small ragtag bands of survivors, from dwarven demolitionists to battle-crazed berserkers, and lead them through a series of 25 missions, fighting or fleeing across 3D battlefields, upon which everything from the geography to the weather will influence gameplay. Marshes impede movement. Snow extinguishes fires, and water conceals hidden foes. The physics of every object in the game are modeled by Myth's engine, so trees will block projectiles and bombs will roll down hills or bounce off the ground. With the forces of the light outmatched and outnumbered, they'll need to use all their tactical acumen and every advantage offered by the terrain in order to defeat their foes and survive the end of all things. Myth began development in the January of 1996, as Bungie Software were basking in the afterglow of the Marathon series. Spearheaded by Bungie co-founder and lead programmer Jason Jones, this trilogy of story-driven first-person shooters had been a major critical and financial success on the Apple Macintosh. But despite the smiles, Bungie were not entirely happy with the response to Marathon. Each entry had sold tens of thousands of copies, which was considered a smash hit on the Mac, but a disappointment by the standards of the PC market. Bungie's business model, like most of the smaller or medium-sized players in the industry, was entirely hit-driven, meaning that a single flop could kill the company. The second game in the series, Dirrendal, was ported to Windows PCs, but Bungie was stung by how many reviewers dismissed it as yet another of the countless Doom clones that had spawned since 1993. Even so, Bungie first took the safest path and began development on a spiritual successor to Marathon. But by that stage, early screenshots of id Software's latest project, Quake, were already dominating the imaginations of FPS fans, and nobody at Bungie wanted to be chasing another developer's tail again. According to Jason Jones, staff began discussing another concept that they'd been kicking around, referred to internally as the Giant Bloody War Game. There are differing accounts as to where this idea came from. Some credit the 1995 fantasy movie Braveheart as the primary influence, its gritty and violent battle scenes supposedly inspiring the team to try and capture the same feeling in a real-time strategy. Another account states that the concept mutated out of Jason Jones's pet project, an experimental 3D engine designed to simulate futuristic tank combat. Jones reportedly had problems getting the vehicle physics to work properly, but the engine was easily retooled for medieval fantasy battles. One employee claims that Jones simply came into the office one day and asked, "What do you think about having this world with 100 guys fighting another 100 guys in 3D? Regardless of the specifics, all accounts agree that Bungie soon ceased development on the Marathon successor to focus on this new and far more exciting project. In a post-mortem, designer Jason Regia stated that the team envisioned the title being set in a dark, amoral world, with gameplay that combined the realism and excitement of action games with the cunning and planning of strategic titles. The game's original design document consisted of two lists: stuff that sucks and stuff that rocks. The former was full of clichés overly prevalent in fantasy, like Tolkien-esque morality, knights in shining armor, and little boys coming of age and saving the world. In their place was Glenn Cook's 1984 dark fantasy novel, The Black Company. Bungie were heavily inspired by the grim setting and complex morality of Cook's world, and endeavored to imitate it in myth's writing and general tone. In terms of stuff that rocks, Regia indicated that the list was dominated by technological innovations, such as height-mapped 3D battlefields, a fully simulated physics system, and multiplayer functionality. For the first year of development, the team's focus was on fleshing out the game's engine and basic features for online play, as Bungie intended to use Myth to debut their free multiplayer platform, Bungie.net, with cross-platform support for both Windows and Macintosh. By fall 1996, Bungie had a working demo to show off to gaming magazines. This early version was extremely rough, with crude AI and pathfinding that meant each side did little more than run towards each other and meet in a bloody knot in the center of the map. But it was immediately obvious to observers that Myth was doing something very different to the standard real-time strategy formula. The RTS genre at this time was not exactly a model of radical innovation. With the success of Warcraft and Command & Conquer, everyone and their dog was churning out derivative titles to try and carve a piece of the pie. Whilst there were certainly more sophisticated war games and turn-based simulations aimed at niche audiences, mainstream RTS games were typically flat, 2D or isometric worlds, with a focus on harvesting and base building. Combat was fairly simplistic and involved a great deal of abstraction when it came to tactics, weather effects, terrain, and projectile modeling. To journalists used to Command & Conquer clones, it was a revelation to watch footage of Myth's battlefields, seeing how archers were being positioned on real 3D hills to take advantage of height, or seeing arrows blown off course to strike friendly units. Bungie tried to explain the concept behind Myth with terms like multi-metric tactical gameplay, but it was entirely unnecessary. Anyone could see that Bungie was doing something new, the closest point of comparison being the 2.5D battlefields of 1995's Shadow of the Horned Rat. In fact, the idea of a fully 3D strategy map was so new to one magazine that the only contemporary reference they could think of was Tomb Raider. Bungie would continue to add new technological innovations throughout development, some of which panned out, such as support for 3DFX graphics cards, and some of which didn't, like customizable user scripts, independent AI-driven wildlife, and realistic 3D fire simulation. Bungie were a relatively small team, even by the standards of the day, described as a frat house by one employee, and not every aspect of game development was handled internally. Towards the end of 1996, Bungie were contacted by Total Audio, a Chicago-based audio production company run by Marty O'Donnell and Michael Salvatori.
Okay, I'm trying to.
Thanks. That was pretty hard.
O'Donnell was acquainted with developers Cyan Worlds, the creators of Myst, and became aware of Bungie due to the Myst team's daily Marathon multiplayer matches. Having been involved in the early development of Myst's sequel, Riven, O'Donnell was excited by the emergence of what he called legitimate movie score music in games. Bungie were originally reluctant to commission music for Myth, instead hoping O'Donnell would improve their sound design. But as story began to take a greater role in development, via cutscenes, the opening crawl, and pre-level narration, O'Donnell's lobbying for a full movie-style score won out. Moving into 1997, the single-player campaign became the focus of Bungie's efforts. Bungie played up the campaign's focus on story, tactics, and continuity between missions, promising that the survivors from both the player and their enemies' forces would be carried over at the end of each level, and that outstanding performance in one level would let the player skip the next one. As with Bungie's technological ambitions, not all of these features would make it to release, and it was the same story with many other elements of the campaign. Early previews indicated that single-player levels would feature a number of collectible items, such as magic swords, invisibility cloaks, boots of water walking, talismans of protection, and many more, only a fraction of which ended up being implemented in the final game. Most of the early unit roster did make it to release intact, though there were a few cuts. Little is known of the vampires and gold shamans, but flying units seem to have been axed relatively late in development. In fact, some cut units, like the creeping Mahir and amphibious Skrail, were complete enough that the modding community was able to restore them many years later. But long before anyone had a chance to play the campaign, beta testers had the opportunity to enjoy Myth's multiplayer carnage. Strictly speaking, Bungie did not employ a quality assurance department, which meant players accepted into the closed betas doubled as both QA testers and on-paid marketing for the game's formal release. That release came in November 1997 for North America, with a European launch in February of 1998. Myth garnered generally positive reviews from the majority of critics. Most reviewers sang the praises of the engine and visuals, noting how fresh and liberating it was to play on proper 3D battlefields with fully modeled physics. The game's uncompromisingly bloody violence was also a positive for many, being called brutal and very satisfying by several reviewers. Reviewers also lauded the single-player campaign's focus on story and background lore, and the dynamism of multiplayer matches. On the negative side, many reviews criticized Myth's intense difficulty and friendly fire mechanics, and observed that in the 1.0 release, the lower difficulty modes were not much more forgiving than the higher ones. Heavy criticism was also directed at the game's camera, as its maximum elevation level was considered to be too close to the ground for the purposes of tactical combat. Another common complaint was the lack of single-player skirmish modes, a random map generator, or map editing tools, which were increasingly the standard for RTS titles of this era. On average, reviewers from across the Atlantic tended to be far harsher on Myth than their American cousins. PC Gamer UK called the gameplay narcoleptic, likening the combat to watching wind-up toys flailing at each other, and echoing complaints that the single-player missions were unnecessarily punishing. PC Zone's Jamie Cunningham was slightly more forgiving, using the metaphor of a flawless engine, but with bodywork in need of attention, though nevertheless gave Myth a lower score than some of its more conventional RTS rivals, such as Auron Games' Dark Reign. Cunningham argued that Myth's focus on technological innovation and instant action came at the expense of strategy and tactics, resulting in mindless frustration over fun. Still, Cunningham did correctly predict that moving forward, Myth's multiplayer mode would be the place to be, joking that it might be the last opportunity to kill Mac gamers before they went extinct. And Myth's multiplayer was indeed a major hit, with Bungie.net soon flooded with players looking for mayhem, murder, and Molotovs. Myth would go on to sell over 350,000 copies, and generate opportunities for further merchandising, from t-shirts to a tie-in comic book. The game made it onto several publications' Game of the Year lists, and whilst Bungie's reputation among PC players was not quite as unassailable as it had been when they were a Mac developer, nobody could dispute that the studio were clearly capable of more than just Doom clones. Although some of the Myth team would stay on to develop the game's sequel, Soulblighter, Jason Jones and a few others broke off to revisit Jones's original 1996 concept of futuristic tank battles. This team, Project Armor, took the Myth engine and began modifying it to accommodate vehicles, aerial combat, permanent deformable terrain, fully polygonal units, and more advanced physics, with the intention of creating a sci-fi successor to Myth. But this project would end up being taken in a wildly different direction, changing code names to Project Monkey Nuts and then Blam, and bore almost no resemblance to its progenitor when it was publicly unveiled at Macworld 1999. Over 20 years after release, Myth retains a small but passionate fanbase, and today it can be played in three ways. In its original form, with the unofficial 1.5 Project Magma fan patch, or as a port to the Myth 2 Soulblighter engine. I'll be using footage from the latter for reasons I'll explain later, but almost everything in this video will apply to all three versions. Myth's single-player campaign consists of a linear sequence of 25 missions, each completely independent of each other. These missions will always be exactly the same no matter what occurred in the previous level, and don't involve any sort of unit or resource management between missions. In each of these missions, the player is provided a small band of troops and given a simple objective to fulfill. Should the player triumph, they will then progress to the next level along with any survivors, who replace unseasoned units of the same type in that subsequent level. The mission objectives across each level are quite varied, and could range from an assassination strike, to holding out against several waves of enemy assaults, to retrieving an item from somewhere on the map, and then escaping. Though the main objective is pretty straightforward, the player will often have to think carefully about how to fulfill it. The player only has a finite number of troops available during a mission, so they need to try and minimize the amount of casualties incurred, and not just try and seek and destroy every enemy on the map. The player's troops may be too weak to risk a frontal assault on certain enemy forces, and will need to bypass them. Or, a specific foe might have a special ability that deters any attack made en masse, and thus must be attacked using unconventional maneuvers. Similarly, the player may find their sub-objectives subject to change during a mission, such as discovering that their path has been blocked off, or a larger enemy force suddenly begins moving to intercept the player before they can escape the map. This means that the player needs to pay close attention to the disposition of their forces and be ready to react to unexpected surprises. On some maps, for example, the enemy have fallen to infighting or engaged a third mutually hostile faction, so the player might see opportunities to lead rival forces into each other's paths and minimize the risk to themselves. But neither the player nor their troops are omnipotent, so there's always a chance of other unexpected surprises concealed in the fog of war, or ambuscades launched from the murky depths of a corpse-choked river. This sort of asymmetrical warfare is made possible by differences in the composition of the light and dark factions. The player always controls the light side, whose basic melee unit is the warrior. Warriors are moderately strong, have a chance at deflecting frontal blows with their shields, and move at a medium speed, which is just enough to overtake fleeing ranged units. The enemy always controls the dark faction, which fields the Thrall as their frontline melee unit. Thrall are significantly slower than the warrior and have no defensive capabilities, but being undead, they don't have to worry about breathing underwater and can therefore cross deep rivers and hide underwater indefinitely. Similarly, the light side ranged unit is the Firbolg Archer, slow and weak, but essential for dealing with certain threats. The dark side's soulless fulfill the same role, but as incorporeal spirits, they can float over any terrain to seize the high ground or attack from unexpected angles. The light and the dark both have access to superhumanly strong melee monsters, the forest giant and the trowl, respectively, and stronger, faster versions of the basic melee units, but looking at the rest of their rosters, the two sides lose any veneer of uniformity. The dark has access to whites, who can erupt in a massive gaseous explosion of paralyzing fluids. There's also the Fetch, medium-range magic users that fling devastating bolts of lightning, and Ghouls, packs of loping, cowardly scavengers that try to ambush weaker units. On the light side, players will usually have access to Dwarves, who toss powerful but temperamental explosive bottles, and Journeymen, slow-moving and ineffective melee fighters, but highly resistant to specific types of damage. Taking into account the vagaries of physics, weather, and terrain, there are few sure things in Myth, but there are some fairly safe assumptions you can make about how units are going to perform in different situations. Dwarves can make mincemeat of Thrall at the right distance, but are extremely vulnerable to soulless, sudden showers, or throwing things uphill. Berserks have an extremely high attack speed and can often close with ranged units before they take too much damage, but a couple of Fetch will leave them in charred ruins. Giant units can annihilate virtually any other unit in the game without breaking a sweat, but their attack speed is too slow to stop them from being swarmed and hacked to pieces by mass charges. The player's level of control over these units is fairly basic. They can be told to move or attack, and in some cases have access to a special ability. Dwarves can use satchel charges, Ghouls can pick up and fling discarded weapons or unexploded artillery, and Journeymen can use mandrake roots to heal wounds. There's not much more you can do with units. They cannot be told to enter special stances, brace themselves, or create shield walls, for example. They can be given slightly more sophisticated orders, like following waypoints or immediately scattering in a random direction, but the most important command is ordering groups of them into formations. Formations in Myth don't grant any special buffs or abilities in themselves, but they do help reduce the likelihood of friendly fire incidents or units getting in each other's way. Simply putting everything in a big clump isn't going to work, as melee units will be blocked from moving to intercept attackers, and ranged units will be unable to fire or will shoot their companions. Enemy forces will also react to the disposition of your forces. Ghouls will shy away from packed melee troops, but will try and flank your formations to get at dwarves, whilst whites will retreat from a line of archers, but will advance on a group of melee units. So overcoming the challenges of Myth's single-player campaign requires having a good handle on the strengths and weaknesses of both the light and dark side units, choosing the site of battle carefully, and being ready to react to unexpected developments. At a superficial level, I suspect it's hard for some people to understand the appeal of Myth's gameplay, especially since a number of its mechanical innovations, if not technological ones, have become pretty widely adopted in the years since. When you hear the words real-time tactical games, you probably think of far more sophisticated close combat simulations, with a much greater level of control over your troops' actions, or hybrid titles with light RPG or management mechanics. Myth's troop formations and secondary unit abilities were already slowly being integrated into mainstream RTS titles, and are pretty standard today. There was undoubtedly some level of conscious restraint on Bungie's part when it came to how much micromanagement they expected of the player. Although it's possible to pause Myth and give orders from the in-level menu, this is clearly not the intended way to play, and Bungie wanted people to be making decisions and giving orders on the fly, not digging through three layers of menus. Myth balances precariously on the fine line between having too many units for effective micromanagement and having too few units to have enough to do. On most levels, Myth squats comfortably on that spot. When you're simultaneously controlling your dwarf's bombardment, your melee unit's flanking maneuver, and your archer's targeted assassinations, without feeling completely overwhelmed by the amount of things you have to do at once. It's a very simple and accessible game. Not a particularly deep one, but pulled off well enough to make it worthwhile. There was a time when this was something Blizzard Entertainment were best known for, executing fairly derivative and pedestrian gameplay mechanics with enough skill to make up for the lack of ambition. Now, Myth, we should keep in mind, was considered ambitious at the time, owing to the 3D battlefields and physics system. But how far does this take the gameplay? Functionally, what difference does it make whether the dwarf's exploding bottle went off course because of simulated physics, or because the attack was simply programmed to have a random chance to land on a different landscape tile? The latter was easy enough to do in conventional 2D RTS before Myth was even revealed to the public. Similarly, dismembered body parts and items can be blown about and scavenged by certain units, but again, this could have been handled in a less technologically advanced engine. In retrospect, was the physics just a gimmick that made you think, oh, that's cool, and move on? Now, when I first played the PC demo of Myth in 97 or 98, I'd already played a few RTS games, but they all seemed so similar that my point of reference at the time was still the Acorn Archimedes port of Dune 2. Going from that to Myth wasn't just a graphical paradigm shift. Actually scanning the hills to try and figure out whether archers could shoot over them, or calculating how likely it was that the dwarf's bottle was going to roll into a river, that was like stepping into a different era for me. But maybe I was just sheltered in that regard, as reviewers were divided. Some shared my understanding that it was a revolution in how RTS were played, others dismissed it as a gimmick. It's possible the release of another 3D-adjacent RTS a couple of months prior to Myth, Cavedog's Total Annihilation, lessened its impact on some reviewers, but I didn't see much evidence of this from reviews of the time. It's a moot point anyway, as looking at how the RTS landscape developed in the years after Myth's release, I feel like the naysayers had the last laugh. 3D worlds and the kind of simulated physics pioneered by Myth did become somewhat more widespread, but the most popular and financially successful RTS titles that followed in Myth's wake were traditional 2D isometric games like Age of Empires II, StarCraft, and Tiberian Sun. Even in the early 2000s, when RTS were still at the height of their popularity and 3D graphics were the standard, many titles stubbornly refused to adopt fully modeled 3D battlefields and physics calculations, or implemented them only so far as to give the illusion of a 3D world, whilst handling the gameplay and ranged combat in pretty much the same way as the RTS of the mid-90s. Why was this? One possible reason is that many players subconsciously shared the same feelings as PC Gamer and PC Zones reviewers. That 3D battlefields and physics simulations looked and felt cool, but really had minimal impact on the core appeal of traditional RTS gameplay. It's telling, I think, that during the development of Monkey Nuts, Bungie would lean more and more into the technology and 3D world, only to discover that these innovations made Monkey Nuts more enjoyable as an immersive 3D shooter, rather than befitting a strategy game. Meanwhile, Warcraft 3's 3D engine was an important component of the game's early versions, when it was intended as an immersive, character-driven experience, but once it had reverted to more traditional RTS gameplay, the 3D aspect was only really relevant to visuals and in-game cutscenes. And looking at the gaming landscape today, you have to ask yourself, where are all the Myth clones? Myth's technological innovations, rightly or not, are often little more than decoration in modern mainstream RTS, and are more likely to be found in subgenres like wargames and combat sims, or in experimental titles. But it's difficult to discuss Myth's other gameplay innovations without mentioning how they tie into its story. Myth's focused squad-scale gameplay and intense difficulty were meant to represent the desperate losing battle the forces of light were fighting against the undead. The player is not controlling whole armies of well-trained, highly disciplined Imperial legionaries or gleaming knights on their noble steeds, but little groups of scattered, misfit survivors from all the humanoid races, thrown together after their own armies were shattered. The game's narrator often references finding himself fighting alongside men he's never seen before, who speak of faraway lands he's never heard of. Even the warrior units, who appear more uniform and well-equipped than their peers, are not actually attached to a specific standing army. The heraldry and colours of these units are listed under names like Order of the Boar, Warriors of Covenant, or Queen's Guard in Myth's internal data files, as they represent the remnants of mercenary groups and city-states that were destroyed many years prior to the events of the game. The player is meant to be experiencing the chaotic skirmishes that take place in the background of the conflict, the unsung tales of rearguard actions and diversionary strikes by small bands of irregular troops. Players were meant to grow attached to these individual soldiers, who would inevitably be lost over the course of the war.
Casualty.
The problem with this is that because Myth's missions are totally independent from one another, it puts the onus to communicate this entirely on the game's writing. Myth, fortunately, features a stellar narrative, but its storytelling isn't always complemented by the gameplay. The player's actions in one mission have absolutely no bearing on the next, and nothing is carried over between levels except the veterancy level of some of your troops. An archer might survive 3 or 4 missions, but you can't scavenge better gear or customize his equipment in any way, check on his status between missions, give him a promotion, or anything of the like. In fact, in classic Myth, you can't even carry him all the way to the end of the game. As if a unit survives, but there are no units of the same type in the subsequent mission, then those units are simply deleted as if they never existed. And any missions with the same unit type after that will simply generate totally new recruits. There's a conflict between trying to keep the player attached to their forces versus the missions themselves effectively being little vignettes jumping between unrelated events, discarding the men we might have grown attached to along the way. It's interesting that some old reviews characterized Myth as a RTS version of Braveheart, which actually turned out to be unintentionally prophetic, since in 1999 Braveheart received a video game adaptation with Myth-style real-time battles. But the difference between Braveheart and Myth was that instead of simply dropping the player into individual battles, Braveheart included a strategic empire management element, meaning that, like, say, the historical Total War games, what happens in a battle has a bearing on the overall campaign, and the forces the player commanded weren't just throwaway resources that were lost between each mission. Sure, Myth's battles take place at a skirmish or warband level, rather than that of a kingdom or large army, but we can look at XCOM-like titles for examples of how some level of regiment or squad management can enhance our sense of attachment to our forces, and ensure the narrative and gameplay are working hand in hand, instead of the narrative having to pick up the slack for shallow gameplay. One problem with this approach, though, is that it means a player's performance could either cripple or completely trivialize an entire campaign. Myth's levels were designed to be pick-up-and-play, not 100-hour marathons like a 4X Empire builder, and reviewers were already pretty harsh on the game's difficulty. I didn't experience Myth's lower difficulty levels before the first patch, but the game was apparently too difficult for a number of reviewers due to how easy it was to end up in an unwinnable situation. If this was such a common problem even in a single, independent 20 to 40 minute mission, I can't imagine how permanent unit losses would have been balanced for 25 levels in a row. Specific frustrations that many reviewers complained about were friendly fire and straightforward bad luck. After its story, Myth's explosive carnage, at times amusing and at times infuriating, is probably what it's best known for today. Call it classical mechanics, or call it Lady Luck being a cold bitch. At some point, your men are going to find an explosive bottle hurtling right back into their faces.
Idiot!
casualty.
Randomization is all well and good, though I think it's generally agreed that a battle or campaign shouldn't hinge on a single unlucky roll, unless it's the player's fault for putting themselves in that situation in the first place. In Myth, you can try and control for these variables as much as possible, but it's very easy for a twist of fate to leave critical units dead before a level's halfway point. To be clear, this was a complaint of the game's regular or lower difficulty levels, not just the legendary mode that became an iconic feature of Bungie titles. But legendary difficulty does help expose the cracks in Myth's gameplay. Legendary is, generally speaking, not an enjoyable way to play Myth. Legendary isn't just a test of the player's knowledge and mastery of the game's core mechanics, but their knowledge of the game's shortcomings. It's one thing to exploit the game's deliberate anti-clumping features to get Trow stuck in hordes of Thrall, or trick Fetch into shooting their own allies. But beating Legendary requires even cheesier tactics, like knowing exactly when and where specific enemies are going to spawn, and abusing the enemy's AI pathfinding and unit targeting routines. Myth's AI fooled a number of reviewers at the time, and there's no shame in that, but one or two did pick up on the fact that the game lacked any sort of random map generation or AI skirmish mode, and the implications of this. Contrary to what some reviewers believed, Myth's AI is actually substantially worse than pretty much any RTS title of its day, including many released years before it. You see, Myth doesn't really have AI opponents at all, at least in the traditional sense of an overall commander, so it can't handle multiplayer battles or anything of the like. The basic AI in Myth is limited to individual units automatically attacking enemies who come into range, or ranged units retreating from foes that get too close for comfort, and that's it. What Myth's single-player campaign does have is a system of incredibly detailed scripts that dictate enemy behavior in each level, giving the impression that enemies are capable of behavior like moving in formation, setting up patrol routes, and guarding key locations. Bungie worked hard to try and cover almost every possible contingency, meaning enemies seem to react dynamically to the player's actions by leading them into ambushes, picking off stragglers who've fallen too far behind, or ignoring the player's attempts to distract them with decoy units. Myth's AI is essentially Half-Life 2's infamous E3 Trap Town demo, where extensive scripting was used to mislead players into thinking that Half-Life 2 actually had working AI. But in Myth's case, this trick is being played for the entire game. Then again, does it matter whether the single-player AI is real or not, since it mimics AI behavior that the player believes is really taking place? Well, yes, because as noted earlier, it limits the kind of gameplay that can be done in the single-player campaign. Myth's levels almost play out like linear, cinematic action-adventure games, with scripted events used to indicate how the enemy responds to the player's progress. This is a great way to tell a story and do some really inventive things, but it means every single battle has to be designed by hand, from scratch. In many other RTS, you could simply dump the player and a single AI on a user-made map, and they would automatically start seeking out resources, building up their forces, or arranging themselves into battle lines. In Myth, they'd just sit there until the end of the world. Myth's single-player campaign is effectively a stuffed bear, with levers and pulleys inside. It can stand there looking very intimidating, but without someone hiding behind it to push and prod and make roaring sounds, it's ultimately a cheap bit of theatre. Taking all these factors into account, I don't think it's too surprising that the tiny number of imitators that were directly influenced by Myth failed to make a mark themselves. Myth's core gameplay is really nothing special. It's just too simplistic by the standards of other real-time tactical titles, either in terms of in-game tactics or due to the omission of any strategic, management, or customization elements outside of battles. And today, the 3D battlefield and physics aren't as fresh and exciting as they were in 1997. When people say, "I wish there were more games like Myth," What they really mean is either, I wish there were more stories like Myth, or I wish there were more single-player levels as well designed as Myth's. And Myth's imitators, by and large, failed to meet either of those expectations. Personally, I just don't care very much about Myth-likes. The shallow gameplay can't hold a candle to the blend of strategy and tactics in games like the old Total War titles, and the game's focus on individual soldiers or squads works much better in games that hew closer to XCOM or RPGs. But this isn't actually a criticism of Myth, it's the opposite. Even if we completely ignore Myth's story, Myth's fantastic single-player campaign is a testament to the talent and hard work of Bungie's level designers and the rest of the studio, even if the underlying mechanics themselves seem fairly unremarkable today. Myth's handcrafted 3D battlefields, from scorching dunes to dead cities, were a revolutionary sight to most RTS players in 1997, and the sight of bombs and body parts bouncing around the maps obviously added an even deeper layer of plausibility to the game's visuals. A number of Myth's graphical features were impressive at the time, but would eventually become standard in games, such as water reflections and detailed particle effects. But there were more specific technological innovations that are still arguably unsurpassed over 20 years later. In most games today, much of the gore and destruction is fleeting. Bodies might burst open and coat the walls in red, or explosions tear wounds in the earth, but for performance reasons, these are usually either temporary or capped by a very obvious decal or corpse limit. In Myth, the carnage of battle is part of what Bungie dubbed their object permanence system, which simply means that dead bodies, twitching limbs, and other battlefield detritus will never be cleaned up by the engine. If a horde of undead are blown to pieces, their blood will permanently stain the ground, and the ruddy chunks of torso left behind can be found where they originally fell, assuming they weren't sent to the moon or smooshed into even smaller bits of flesh by subsequent explosions. It's spectacularly violent and leaves its mark in more ways than one. In other RTS, factions might have fought over the same site hundreds of times, yet within minutes the bodies will have completely decomposed or sunk into the earth, leaving the ground as unmarked and pristine as they first found it. But when two sides meet in battle in Myth, the ground will be a carpet of blood, viscera, blackened craters, and discarded weapons. You get a real sense of the odds stacked against humanity when, to paraphrase the game, yet another wave of mindless thralls stumble over the slippery pile dead and throw themselves into your lines. Now, the permanent system isn't perfect. For example, blood cannot stain any part of the battlefield except the map itself, which means it can turn heath and hill into a sea of red, but not the units themselves, the scenery props, or structures. This does affect the way maps are built. You can easily notice which parts of a bridge are a 3D model and which parts are actually part of the terrain, but it's still a fantastic feature that can make modern games seem very backward in their depiction of battlefield destruction. Since we're on the topic of the units and structures, it's worth explaining why this was one area where Myth was perhaps not as far ahead of the curve. Although most buildings and artificial landmarks are 3D polygonal models, the units themselves are merely 2D sprites. Myth's unit models were originally created using an $80,000 Silicon Graphics workstation that Bungie had purchased with the profits from the Marathon series. The figures were rendered as 3D models and then converted into octodirectional 2D sprites. Bungie had plenty of experience from previous titles making 2D sprites, but they said that the Silicon Graphics workstation let them make much higher quality figures and also substantially improved their workflow, letting them view all the models at different angles and animation cycles more easily. I think most people would agree that going the 2D route was a far better option than trying to make 3D polygonal models in an RTS. As whilst the full 3D approach was starting to become widespread, having to optimize so many unit models on screen at once would not have been a pretty sight. If you look at Myth's contemporaries, even first-person shooters and action adventures of the era had to push a very specific type of art style to fit their creature and character models. Even several years later, when hardware and technology had improved quite a bit, Warcraft 3's comically exaggerated proportions caused a small outcry among some Blizzard fans. Had Myth gone with polygonal units, it probably would have looked much, much worse. Now, it's easy to assume that by going with 2D sprites on late 90s hardware, Bungie didn't have to worry so much about optimizing the unit models, but this isn't actually true. Several reviewers criticized Myth's units for appearing too jerky, and sometimes looking out of place in the 3D environments, depending on which angle they were viewed from. In his post-mortem, Jason Regier admitted that for most of the project, Bungie couldn't pin down exactly how much memory would be consumed by demands like large texture maps and the extensive sound library. Bungie were overly conservative and ended up rendering the units with too few frames of animation, even by the standards of the time, and didn't have time to re-render them before release. This resulted in comments like PC Gamer's reference to the units as looking like wind-up toys. All that aside, Myth's cast of heroes and villains look great at pretty much any resolution. They have strong, recognizable silhouettes that help you pick them out in the heat of battle, but also look pretty detailed and realistic. You can see the pallid, clammy flesh and smears of blood on the thrall, or the musculature on the Firbolg's bare legs. And whilst I absolutely adore the swords and sorcery style of barbarians in loincloths and sorceresses in silk nightgowns that some fantasy titles still favoured in the 90s, Myth wisely opted for a generally down-to-earth look, with sensible armour and reasonably sized weapons. This is evident at all levels of the project, from the concept and background art to the in-game graphics, and to a lesser extent the animated cutscenes. It's been speculated that what reviewers referred to as the anime or Disney-style animated cutscenes were a deliberate stylistic choice on Bungie's part, or a matter of some Bungie employees' personal tastes. But in official material, Bungie have admitted that it was a purely financial decision. Having storyboarded these cutscenes, Bungie shopped around for contractors and discovered that pre-rendered 3D graphics were far outside their price range. Hence the slightly more cartoonish style compared to the rest of the game's visual direction. It's probably a good thing that Bungie didn't go for the Conan or Dungeons & Dragons look, as having armies of pin-up models in chainmail bikinis or superheroes wielding gigantic hammers might have detracted from the type of story Bungie were trying to tell in The Fallen Lords. An absolutely indispensable part of this story is, of course, the sound. It's difficult to overstate the contribution that Total Audio's Marty O'Donnell and Michael Salvatore made to Myth, and fans who followed the game's development from its earliest days were quick to notice the aural differences between early previews of the game and how it sounded when Total Audio were done with it.
Casualties.
Bungie founder Arik Seropian had done a lot of the sound work on Bungie's previous titles, but when it came to Myth, Total Audio were given almost complete free rein on the project. According to Marty O'Donnell, Salvatore had no interest whatsoever in the nitty-gritty of sound effects and ambience, so O'Donnell was the primary influence on Myth's sound design. Reading into the history of Myth's sound design, it's easy to characterize it as the story of Marty O'Donnell, the seasoned professional, riding in to save the team of bumbling amateurs at Bungie. But O'Donnell has always taken pains to give credit to Bungie for Myth's pre-existing sound engine. When O'Donnell was working at Cyan Worlds on very early prototypes of Riven, sound was handled in a very rudimentary way. To represent environmental sounds, the game would play tracks of ambient noise that would loop after several minutes, whilst individual sound effects, when triggered, were completely unaffected by factors like distance from the player or the physical context in which they were played. In Myth's engine, O'Donnell was able to represent true randomized ambient sounds, and the game could model numerous factors that would influence noise, such as the environment and how far they were from the camera. In hiring Total Audio, Bungie also bought themselves access to O'Donnell and Salvatore's professional contacts, including Chicago-based voice talent.
The rest of your legion has been destroyed, Alric!
Give me his head, and I will let you live.
That's f***ing cool!
All of these made wonderful contributions to Myth, including Marty O'Donnell's own father, who played the surly dwarves. But the most memorable of these has to be the narrator. Originally, Bungie had hoped the narrator could be played by that guy from Braveheart, as they put it to Marty O'Donnell. That guy being Patrick McGoohan, who played King Edward I. O'Donnell humoured Bungie, promising to put them in contact with McGoohan's agents, but knew nothing would come of it. And in the meantime suggested that they do some readings with Geoffrey Charlton Perrin, who O'Donnell was already in contact with. O'Donnell demoed one of the opening crawls with Charlton Perrin's narration and his music, and so Bungie ended up with two of Myth's most memorable features.
Heroes were born in the fire and bloodshed of the wars which followed, and their names and deeds will never be forgotten.
O'Donnell was able to convince Bungie that every opening crawl and cutscene needed its own unique musical accompaniment. And here, Michael Salvatore came back into a creative role, composing the opening music for the Siege of Madrigal level, for example. O'Donnell and Salvatore shared Myst composer Robin Miller's belief that music in games should be like a movie score, that it should come in when it was needed and not be there when it wasn't. This approach to Myth's soundtrack wasn't to everyone's taste, though. Having been raised on the Command & Conquer series, some reviewers disliked the absence of music for keeping them energized and engaged during gameplay. True, Myth might not have the infallible effervescence of a Frank Klopaki score, but the movie-style soundtrack freed the composers up to focus on telling a story with the music, not worry about it droning on in the background for hours on end. Like its narrative, Myth's soundtrack is sometimes maudlin and sometimes menacing, but never overstays its welcome. Myth's soundtrack received an official physical release that's still popular among collectors, but this soon found its way online and was disseminated pretty widely. In 2021, Marty O'Donnell actually put a free, high-quality version of the original soundtrack up on his Bandcamp account, telling fans not to waste money trying to find a second-hand copy on Amazon. Unfortunately, at the time of this review, this, along with the music for several other Bungie titles, has been taken down from O'Donnell's Bandcamp, presumably as a result of his unpleasant legal battles with Bungie and Activision Blizzard over Destiny. Luckily, like the physical release, these materials aren't too hard to track down and acquire for free from other sources. And that brings us to the most important point. How can you play Myth today? None of the Myth games receive digital releases, though as of this video, they aren't obscenely difficult to find on Amazon or eBay, and whoever owns the rights doesn't seem to be working too hard to have them removed from popular abandonware sites. Copies of the original game will almost certainly fail to launch on modern systems, but thanks to the hard work of the Myth fan community, that shouldn't be a problem. If you have a copy of the game, first make sure it's fully installed and patched to version 1.3, Bungie's final official release of the game. You'll then need a couple of extra tools, Melkor's TFL launcher, which bypasses the memory limitations, and some kind of glide wrapper. The latter isn't strictly necessary, but it allows the game to be rendered in 3DFX mode, which is strongly recommended unless you really like that chunky software look. The second method of playing Myth is using Project Magma's unofficial 1.5 patch. This adds a lot of little improvements to the original game, most notably support for widescreen aspect ratio and higher resolutions. I originally intended to use this version of the game for this video, since it seemed pretty close to the classic Myth experience, but I noticed there was something off about the terrain. It seems a particularly sharp-eyed Myth fan noticed this problem as early as 2009, and after some back and forth, it was determined that OpenGL wasn't rendering the color maps properly. This limitation causes noticeable banding issues that make the maps in Project Magma's 1.5 look worse than the original games. This issue was never fixed, and combined with other problems I ran into on this patch, I have to recommend giving this version of the game a miss. It's playable, it's just not optimal. The final option for playing the Fallen Lords, and the one I've used for this video, is Project Magma's Fallen Levels add-on for the latest unofficial version of Myth 2 Soulblighter. This ports the entire campaign from the Fallen Lords into its sequels engine, and is supported by a number of add-ons meant to make playing these levels as close as possible to the classic experience. Most notably the TFL Gameplay and Physics add-ons, the Real Craters add-on, and the TFL interface. This brings the same improvements from the unofficial 1.5 patch, such as widescreen support, and has also been updated to fix the color map issues, making it pretty much the de facto choice for playing Myth the Fallen Lords today. As a longtime fan of the original Myth, I should point out that this isn't a 100% faithful port. There are small deviations from the vanilla TFL gameplay, such as the way experience and veterancy are handled between levels, and some very minor omissions in the scripts for certain single player levels. There are other differences, like the flavor text for some units using the tags from the sequel rather than the original game, but most notably, for me at least, the bleeding and blood splatter effects using the more realistic but less entertaining spurting effect of Myth 2. A diehard fan will probably notice this more in the later levels, especially in the penultimate level, which could get pretty messy in the original game. All the same, the Fallen Levels opens up further opportunities to tweak Myth to your liking. Some of these are built into the Project Magma patch, such as motion interpolation to create the illusion of smoother animations, whilst others are fully fledged visual overhaul mods. The most popular of these are the Myth HD pack, which replaces the unit sprites, as well as John God's Detail Texture Mega Pack and Akven's AI Upscaled Texture Pack, both of which overhaul the landscape and scenery. I don't use these mods myself, as I think some of the textures deviate too much from the original art, and in some cases the unit sprites are too high fidelity and look incongruous with Myth's jerky animation frames. Also, the gore effects seem to be slightly off. Still, I think you can see for yourself just what a difference they make to the original graphics. Many Myth fans swear by them today, so you can decide for yourself. To me, there's really nothing wrong with using the original 1.3 version of Myth the Fallen Lords, but I understand I'm coming from the perspective of a nostalgic. For the vast majority of players, old and new, the Fallen Levels port is an excellent way to enjoy the original game. And of course, if you do enjoy it, you're now already set up for plenty more Myth madness.
You fools! Where do you think you're going?
We're going to the shrine to pray for help.
Then you waste your time. The gods aren't listening.
Myth takes place upon a world in the twilight of its existence. 100 years ago, the Cathbarig Empire ruled over the fertile lands of the east, and the imperial capital of Myrthemni hosted the most learned scholars and sorcerers of the age. To the south, the ingenious dwarves produced miracles of engineering and smithmanship from their ancestral cities of Myrgard and Stoneheim, whilst across the Cloudspine Mountains lay the province and the free cities of the north, a patchwork of querulous kingdoms and independent city-states. But all this was before the coming of the Dark. From the east came Balor, a merciless sorcerer king of unmatched might, leading legions of corpses, fell spirits, and creatures from all the savage and tyrannical races of the world. Balor bent 6 other terrible warlocks and necromancers to his will, who collectively became known as the Fallen Lords. For decades, the armies of the Cath Brug fought the Fallen, but to no avail. Their lands were torched, becoming a lifeless wasteland known as the Barrier, and the Imperial Seat was razed to the ground. In 50 years, an empire of millennia was wiped from the face of the earth. In the south, the dwarves were assaulted by hordes of their ancestral enemies, the Gauls. Mirgard fell, and Stoneheim's defenders destroyed their own city rather than let it suffer the same outrage, leaving the survivors to scatter to the winds. The Fallen Lords were not satisfied with these victories, and with the scouring of the east accomplished, they marched across the Cloudspine to continue their war of annihilation. The armies of the province threw themselves against the passes of Bagrada and Seven Gates, bolstered by an alliance of other humanoid races, such as the Firbolg of the Ermine and the Giants of Forest Heart. But the armies of the dead were unstoppable, and year after year, the forces of light would be forced back, every army shattered, every city sacked. Soon, only the free cities of the north remained, led by an alliance of arch-wizards known as the Nine. 7 years later, the city of Madrigal is the final stand of the living against the dead, the survivors of every civilized mortal race of the known world against a billion walking corpses. Myth opens just after Madrigal is besieged by the Fallen, with the armies of the north racing towards the city in the hopes of preventing its fall. The story is delivered by an unnamed narrator attached to a northern legion. The narrator's scribblings are annals of death and defeat, a journal of dead men and burning cities that the narrator writes out of force of habit, something to occupy them between fighting and sleeping. He knows that the war is futile, that the scruffy rabble he fights alongside, their backs to the sea, cannot save this blackened continent. He asks himself why he still fights, why any of the Legion still fight, and finds no answer. The Legion are no heroes, merely hard-edged, dependable veterans picked for the nastiest duties. Diversionary strikes, rearguard actions, and other dangerous work. Recently, rumors have been circulating of the Nine's discovery of some new weapon that will change the course of the war. Something that will reverse 7 years of retreats, that will break the inexorable tide of undead that crashes against Madrigal's bloody walls. The Legion have heard this story too many times before to give it any credence. But privately, the narrator wonders how many in the Legion want to believe this story. He asks himself, would we carry on, hoping for a future beyond war, if we hadn't a chance? Soon enough, the Legion discover that there is something to this tale. There was a secret buried beneath the ruins of Mirthemni, one that will set the Legion on a desperate mission across the Cloudspine and into the lifeless plains of the East. If there is salvation for the living, it must be pried from the grip of civilizations long past, but its price will be the death of the North. I think too much is made of Myth as some sort of wholly unique and original fantasy setting. Armies of the dead, ancient powers and principalities, a last alliance of humanity and the Fey races against the tide of darkness, none of this is new to even the most casual fan of fantasy. Bungie were very keen to differentiate themselves from Tolkien-esque fantasy, but the background lore is still caught in Middle-earth's orbit, with some elements being a twist on or retelling of Tolkien's stories, rather than something completely fresh. The dwarven diaspora of Mirgard and Stoneheim, for example, is very much in the vein of Tolkien's original depiction of the Underfolk. Where there are more significant deviations, these are only really notable because they're inspired by slightly less popular sources. Most generic fantasy mind the mythology of Greco-Roman, Anglo-Saxon, and broader Germanic literature, but Myth branches out a little by also drawing heavily from, for example, Celtic and occasionally Mesoamerican fables. But probably the greatest influence on Myth's world and writing was Glenn Cook's The Black Company, almost certainly up to and including 1990's The Silver Spike, and probably a few of the books beyond that. The Black Company follows a company of mercenaries drawn into the service of the Lady and the Ten Who Were Taken, ancient, undying sorcerers who have returned to the world after hundreds of years. Among the Taken are Soulcatcher, the Hanged Man, the Faceless Man, the Shifter, and others with similar titles. The Taken are resisted by the 18, a circle of archmages who lead an uprising against the Lady and await the arrival of a blazing comet that will herald their salvation. The story is narrated by Croker, the Black Company's surgeon and analyst, who finds that the company are as much in danger from the Taken as they are from the rebels, for the Ten use their forces as pawns in a secret war with each other, acting on enmities as bitter as they are ancient. Myth hosts plenty of overt references to the characters and events of the Black Company, from the Fallen Lords themselves, who in early versions of Myth had their names lifted directly from the Ten Who Were Taken, to the Nine Avatara, the secret beneath Muir Themni, and the cosmic cycle of the comet. But these are mostly superficial parallels, and the two stories eventually head in completely different directions. A more pervasive and abiding influence the Black Company had on Myth was its thematic and stylistic treatment of a war between light and dark. In interviews, Glenn Cook said he wasn't interested in writing about storybook heroes, but ordinary, everyday people caught up in a situation that was beyond them. Just like Croker, Myth's narrator is an unremarkable figure. Just another member of the poor bloody infantry that are thrown into the meat grinder whilst the heroes of the story duel in front of pretty backgrounds. Very little is known of the narrator beyond faded memories of lugging pumpkins around his grandfather's farm or being chased by livestock. The narrator is frequently absent from pivotal moments in the war against the dark, relaying events from third parties or rumours floating around the campfires, in some cases months after the events actually happened. Outside of the cutscenes and some brief in-game encounters, we never really get an authoritative glimpse into the actions and intentions of the leading figures in the conflict. Everything we know about important events that occurs outside the missions is reported via the narrator, who usually heard it from someone else, and there are many such events. During the Siege of Madrigal, or the encirclement at Seven Gates, or other historic moments, the player and narrator are miles away, searching for lost scouting parties or digging in the dirt for artifacts. Much of the time, the story of Myth is the story of historical footnotes. The use of a first-person narrator isn't taken as far as it could be. There's no real concern of the narrator being misinformed or deceitful, or the journal itself having been tampered with. We can generally assume that when the narrator has written something as fact, it's an accurate retelling of the history of the war. It might seem counterintuitive to deliberately avoid depicting some of the most exciting and significant developments in the war, but it lends a sense of intimacy to the narration. Reading the journal of an ordinary man who is often more interested in getting some hot food in his belly than watching sorcerous duels between demigods. This conceit does start to become a little less effective later on, when the Legion takes a more important role in the war, and the player starts to wonder why certain events mentioned by the narrator were not depicted in-game. And skipping through significant periods of time doesn't always work as well as it does in The Black Company, as it occasionally becomes slightly confusing or insufficiently informative. I found the transition between the penultimate level and the final mission very unsatisfying, for example. But it's an interesting approach to storytelling that you don't often see in RTS. At the time of release, story-heavy strategy games used a very cinematic style of narration, making extensive use of pre-rendered or in-game cutscenes. And this became even more popular in the late 90s and early 2000s, with heroes and villains strutting around like actors on a stage, spelling out every single detail for the benefit of the audience. Bungie was sparing enough with information to strike a balance between passing references to disposable fantasy gobbledygook and over-explaining the cosmic forces and ancient mysteries of Myth's world. It's almost ironic that Bungie wanted to distance themselves from Tolkien's Legendarium, as like Tolkien's Middle-earth, Myth teases a world of untold epics beyond the scope of the story at hand. Bungie were very good at revealing just enough to drive hardcore fans into a frenzy of theory crafting, intimating that there was some sort of authoritative Myth Bible that fans could uncover by, for example, buying multiple copies of Bungie products. Something else Myth supposedly borrowed from the Black Company was its perspective on good and evil. In the Black Company, this is a major theme, with the company following a code of honor that wasn't always consistent with that of the lands they served in. And even then, the company often struggled to balance their attachment to the company creed with the reality of the situation on the ground. Within the company, individual loyalties were often complicated, torn between the company as a whole, their employers, allied regiments, compatriots, loved ones, and most dangerous of all, abstract moral principles. As the company became more intimate with the major players of the war, this theme would extend to the Taken and the Rebel Wizards, who had their own convoluted web of friendships, romantic attachments, and unavenged injustices. Bungie insisted that Myth drew heavily from these themes, and to some extent this is evident in the final product. Early in the game, it becomes clear that Balor's domination of the Fallen Lords has its limits, as two in particular, the Watcher and the Deceiver, are constantly at each other's throats, happily interfering in each other's plans and sabotaging each other's armies at every opportunity they get. A less obvious case is that of Soulblighter, whose motivations are never explicitly spelled out, but have been the subject of many fan theories. Initially, the armies of the North seem more united in their cause, but an event later in the game, which is never really elaborated on, does raise a few questions. Overall, though, I don't think this theme is taken as far as Bungie claimed. I certainly would not call Myth a dark, amoral world, as Jason Regier put it. The Black Company followed morally flexible mercenaries working for an ostensibly evil tyrant against an ostensibly noble rebellion, and then stirred the pot to make things even more complicated, whereas Myth follows warriors of the light against slaves of the dark, with no real exploration of either side's morality. We don't have a window into the thoughts of the Ghouls, the Trow, or the Myrmidons beyond what's stated in the manual and their in-game flavor text, and the motivations of the Fallen Lords are almost exclusively inferred from their actions. All we know, really, is that the Dark is there to end the world, and the Light is there to save it. This certainly makes the Light and the Dark less intriguing than the Rebels and the Taken, but it's understandable Bungie went with this approach in light of the tone of Myth's story. A losing battle for the fate of the world is not the most original backdrop to a fantasy, but the way in which this is told is what sets Myth apart. Myth's story is often described as bleak and unheroic. I would go so far as to say that Myth is almost an apocalyptic or post-apocalyptic fantasy setting. The armies of the North are not fighting to save the civilized world. The civilized world is already destroyed. The great enemy came, and he won. When Myth opens, the vast majority of the continent already consists of lost kingdoms and exterminated empires. True, at the beginning of the game, the player sees the few untouched settlements left in the West. Lush greens and chalky whites, fields of fat pumpkins and pretty peasant girls, but virtually every level after that is a picture of desolation, uninhabitable wasteland or razed cities. It seems like the rest of the world is truly dead. The tone only becomes darker as the story progresses, for even as it seems like the Legion are winning small victories against the Dark, back in the West, the war of attrition continues, and the Light is still losing. This never veers too far into parodic territory. Myth isn't a deliberately exaggerated heavy metal cover, and it has lighter moments throughout, but these are coloured by an undertone of defeatism. a feeling of despair lurking behind every victory that never quite comes to the fore, but is never fully dispelled either. In essence, the Light is no longer fighting for victory. Too much has been lost for that. Instead, it flickers like a fading ember, stubbornly refusing to go out even when the fire itself has already died. Myth's ending is emotionally a gentle one. No trumpets or victorious cheers, just a sense of finality, like survivors emerging in the deadly quiet after a disaster. Not defeated, not triumphant, just alive. It's an ending that would have been abrupt or unsatisfying with a more traditional style of storytelling, but it works well in the context of a soldier's journal. A carefully preserved fragment of a greater story lost to time. It's this feeling that Myth's campaign is a single story ripped from the pages of a greater work of history that leaves me fairly nonplussed about the fact that neither the Myth series nor this very specific subgenre of RTS survived more than a couple of years after its birth. Even if Myth 2 had never existed, Myth is an experience that works perfectly well, better, perhaps, in isolation, as a story, and in some ways as a game. Where can you go with Myth's gameplay? Lean into the role-playing and individual soldiers, and you'd end up with XCOM or an RPG. Lean into the strategic element, and you've got a Total War or an Empire Builder. There are certainly tweaks that could be made to the formula, but overall I'm not too bothered that Myth didn't become a long-running franchise or launch a new style of RTS. If someone showed me a perfect simulacrum of Myth with 21st century graphics, I'd be interested, but not bowled over like I was in 1997. That doesn't mean Myth isn't worth playing, as it's a game that does so well in so many different areas that even people who don't normally enjoy strategy games or tactical war games should at least give it a chance. And it certainly doesn't mean that Myth's sequel isn't worth playing, or that the map-making and modding community that exploded with the release of the Fear and Loathing tools didn't produce anything worthwhile. The original Myth does actually have some custom content on top of multiplayer maps and minor tweaks. There were some campaigns designed specifically for the Fallen Lords, such as the Dark campaign, which uses the same levels but swaps out your forces for the enemies, or Sir Moriak's Tale, a full-length, story-driven custom campaign with completely new maps and missions. It's worth looking into these if you really enjoyed Myth, but I decided against covering them in this video. As interesting as they are, Myth 2's map-making community is the 300-pound gorilla in the room. There are so many single-player custom campaigns to cover for that game that I'll save my energy for when I do the Myth 2 retrospective. Probably around the same time next year. And yes, I'll do Myth 3 one day too, despite its reputation. As with all my videos, I'd like to thank fans, modders, and general tech enthusiasts who have kept retro games alive, playable, and easily available on GOG or abandonware sites in the many years since their creators or IP holders stopped caring about them. If you enjoyed Myth's story, or you haven't played it but I somehow made it sound interesting, then I wholeheartedly recommend the first book of The Black Company if you haven't read it yet. And if you disagreed with my assessment of Myth's legacy, and you feel there are some games that hit the same spots, leave a recommendation for other people down in the comments. The Fallen Lords is one of my favourite games of all time. So I hope old-timers got a kick out of this video, and newcomers are persuaded to try it out. Happy mything, everybody, and if you're watching this video around the same time I uploaded it, then have a very Merry Christmas too.
Game on.